Meanwhile, the several nations of the world are being swallowed up in the coming world empire. Each day the contours of this seventh head become clearer. Naturally, we are angry that our troops are being evacuated from Djoka. We regard it as a disgrace to the Dutch flag, an insult to our nation, a mockery of our boys who have risked their lives for nothing. But shall I tell you something? Within a half year we will forget this, and after 20 years our children will assume that all this was proper. But then, at that time, we shall be painfully aware that the beast has been healed of his death wound. We tremble when the Russians act sullenly in Berlin, and when, as in recent days, the bombers again streak throughout our skies, we ask anxiously, is anything serious in the offing? When the Russians are a little friendlier, we again take a deep breath and say, no war yet. And to be sure, everyone wants the big four to agree. People applaud when our prime minister affixes his signature to some solemn pact, supposing that this is the road to world peace. At school, too, our children must be brought up to date on the United Nations. But no one speaks about the seventh head. Small wonder that the beast laughs. Not too much enthusiasm is evident, since everyone betrays a tendency to perpetuate the traditional. But all are agreed that the present developments are demanded by our times. Thus, tomorrow already, they can begin to worship the beast. Never war again, but prosperity, thanks to the United Nations. Perhaps the Russians will first have to be put in their place. Only then never another war, but perpetual peace. Are there, then, not some things 1,000 times more terrible than even a war with nuclear weapons? Is not this the worst of all, that the old monster is once more alive and raises himself up to spew destruction over the face of the earth? Would that we worried less about the chances of a coming war. So long as these chances are present, the time of the end is not yet come. Would that we stopped talking about economic problems and soberly assessed the spirit of the age, that with full speed we are steering in the direction of the seventh head. This is the seventh manifestation of Babel, a totally godless world, wherein we shall stand all alone, since therein is no room for God, and for his Christ, and for his tabernacle, and for those who serve him there. When I read all this, I can understand why John was so shocked by this vision. Yet I believe that his perplexity actually had a deeper source. He was frightened most of all by that woman seated on the scarlet beast. You will remember that earlier in Revelation, John introduced us to a woman clothed with the sun, having the moon under her feet, and adorned with the crown of 7 stars on her head. This was the church, bedecked with the glory from above, because she was enabled to bring forth Christ in this world, and to become the mother of the holy seed. But here is the woman clothed with the glory which is from below, with purple, scarlet, gold, and jewels and pearls. And why was John so frightened by this? The answer is simple. This woman is also the church, but then the apostate church, who was the bride, but became a prostitute. Upon her forehead, John saw her name, precisely as all the harlots in the Roman Empire carried their names inscribed upon their foreheads. And this name was Babylon the Great. But John adds, this is a mystery. One must not think here of the city of Babel or the kingdom of Babylon. This must be understood figuratively, spiritually, precisely as John speaks in chapter 11 of Jerusalem, as a city which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt, where our Lord was crucified. Thus he clearly pointed to Jerusalem. So it is also here. The official name of this woman is not Babylon, but spiritually she deserves to be called Babylon. In this woman, who has become a harlot, in this apostate church is revealed the spirit of the ancient Babylon, who no longer saw an opportunity to incorporate itself in a world empire, but recognized the opportunity to assume this form within the church. That church is Babylon, because he does what the world empires have wanted to do since the beginning, seeking unity without believing in the promise and without concerning herself with God's demand. And while doing this, she calls herself church, bedecked with the glory of heaven, even though she is Babylon. For she seeks her glory in this present world and sells her soul for the treasures which pass away. Calling herself the wife of God and the bride of Christ, she is actually the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth, the chief prostitute. This, of course, does not compel us to think only of immorality, although this is included. You will remember that when the Bible speaks of committing adultery, this describes the church in the act of forgetting God, who is her husband, and of breaking the covenant. Adultery is present when the church transgresses God's commandments. In that connection, and in consequence of this, the abomination of licentiousness appears. But this adultery is the total, radical apostasy, the breach of the covenant, and the murder of her children. It is striking that when John speaks of the beast, he refers to Daniel. But when he speaks of that woman, he reminds us of Ezekiel 16 and 23, where we find the same message. You should read that once again. When God drove Jerusalem into captivity and punished her, he said, Sodom was bad, and Samaria was even somewhat worse, but Jerusalem was the worst prostitute which the world has ever seen. This was also John's consternation. The woman, arrayed with the light of heaven, had exchanged the glories from above for the treasures of this earth. She had abandoned the word, even though God was her husband. And because she was a bad wife for the Lord, she became a bad mother for her children. John saw her drunk with the blood of saints and the witnesses of Christ. Instead of nurturing her children in the Lord, she sinned against them so greatly that she became dead drunk with the blood of her own children. Do you suppose that John did not know what was happening in his time? He surely saw the Jews persecuting the Christians. In the Jewish congregation, the synagogue of Satan, Revelation 2 verse 9, we again discover the woman who became a harlot, the church which broke the covenant with the Lord, and therefore killed her true children. Read then the rest of the pages of history. What did the Roman Catholic Church do? What did the Reformed State Church of the Netherlands do? What did the synodical bound churches do? One may say that today there is no bloodshed, yet there is a persecution which is more bitter than death. As often as the church abuses church discipline against her children, God says that she is drunk with the blood of the saints. I do not maintain that outside of the liberated churches no one is saved. Let me emphasize this. For from what I have just said, the conclusion is frequently and unblushingly drawn that the liberated churches announce themselves as the only churches wherein salvation is found, which is completely erroneous. I indeed believe that with the synodical bound churches and with the Reformed State Church, there are those who are saved. I also believe that there are Roman Catholics who are saved. But this is not the issue. The point is rather whether we are dealing with an apostate church which slays the brothers. Nor is this a passing quarrel, but rather one which rocks the world in the last days. What, after all, does it mean that also there some people are saved? Ask rather how many millions have been driven into hell by the Roman Catholic Church. Italy, France, Spain, Belgium. These are lost, and the true Christian life has disappeared without a trace. Are there Reformed State Church members who are saved? Thanks be unto God, indeed. But how many hundreds of thousands have perished within a single century here in the Netherlands because this church was apostate? Entire generations, which 60 years ago were Orthodox, but as concerned believers remained within the false church, now seem to be irrevocably lost to Christ. So serious is the apostasy of the church. So dreadful is it when the church makes a game of the covenant and thus becomes unfaithful to her children. Therefore, it is not a question whether one can be saved there, but rather what we are doing with the generations to come. In this connection, I should also touch on the question closely related to the above. This is discussed from time to time among us, the problem of cooperation. I realize full well that people do not find a ready solution to this, and therefore are afraid to withdraw from an association which God does not want to see destroyed. But what I cannot understand is that Christians who can no longer see the possibility of cooperation in specific situations are accused of seeking to destroy everything. That even within their own church, they are compelled to listen to voices that mock with a separate church, a separate political party, a separate newspaper. The matter really isn't so simple. If the sole motive were an inordinate desire to be separate, then the cause certainly should come to naught. But to this I add, woe to him among us who is not disturbed by the basic issues which are involved. It simply is a fact that nearly all Christian organizations no longer are concerned about departing from the Lord and His Word. They champion a set of lovely theories which they call principles, but faithfulness to God's covenant is nowhere taken seriously, and nowhere is there concern about the murders which are committed within the church. If the covenant of the Lord and loyalty to the true children of the church no longer grip men's hearts, then I don't know what will happen. But I do know that this is the spirit of adultery, and that such cooperation is not a manifestation of the communion of the saints controlled from above, but rather a striving after the proverb, "In unity lies our strength," in the spirit of Babel. Of this the Bible declares, "Judgment will come upon it." If it were only thus, they have an organization and we too, they have a newspaper and we too, thus a matter of competition, then we would be guilty of the same sin. But surely the goal is not the organization, but the salvation of men for Jesus Christ and His coming. All organization is purely secondary. Our concern is not for the school, but the children. And because the salvation of whole generations in the Netherlands is involved in this, therefore no mere man may deal lightheartedly with these matters, especially in our day, when we see the contours of the seventh head. This adultery, let this be remembered, is international. John beholds the woman sitting upon the seven heads. He said that these are the seven hills of Rome, which in those days was the capital of the world. A little later he added that she sits among many waters, peoples, nations, and tongues. The church is an international power. This is actually the most dreadful of all. Therefore he passes here so long. When the beast in its sixth head received the deadly wound and loses the opportunity for centuries to establish a world unity and thus a political international power, the church becomes throughout this period an international power and by means of her false unity manifests the image of Babel. Never think lightly about the apostasy of the church. John declares that she rules over the kings of the earth. In her apostasy, the church has pursued earthly power and obtained it. Who really are in control among the peoples of the world? The leaders of the apostate church. The church is the chief figure in world politics. All the kings of the earth have committed adultery with her and catered to her. All the inhabitants of the earth are drunk with the wine of her adultery. For all men are intoxicated with a Christian culture which is actually apostate. You know, of course, that Christianity is strong in Europe and America. We speak of Christian Europe and Christian America and proclaim that all of cultural life is Christian. But who had power in Russia in the past? The Tsars. Yet over them stood the Greek Catholic Church, the Harlot. In Spain, Philip II ruled, but the Roman Catholic Church was in control. In France there was Louis XIV, but the Harlot really ruled. A century and more ago in the Netherlands, William I was king, but the Reformed State Church committed adultery with him. Never throughout the centuries has there been a pure worldly political power. The actual power rested with the apostate church, the Harlot. What went wrong in Indonesia? Was this the result of an inefficient government, the consequence of interference by the Security Council? The situation went wrong because behind the scenes was the Roman Catholic Church and the Reformed State Church, which even sent two pastors to America to oppose police action. Behind the scenes were American Christendom and the World Council of Churches. When speaking about political matters, we use political designations as Jews, liberals, Roman Catholics. But none of these names can be used without using an ecclesiastical term. The Jew and the liberal and the Roman Catholic, these are again and again the children of the harlot. The apostate church has not understood her heavenly calling, but reached out after worldly power. All the misery in Indonesia and throughout the world was born in the church, who is the harlot. Would history have taken its present course in Russia if the Greek church had not committed adultery for centuries with the Tsars? Would the recent misery have come upon Indonesia if the churches throughout the world had not committed adultery? The whole course of human history since the days of the Roman Empire has been dominated by the apostate church. When in our day the world empire, the seventh head, is being built, this is occasioned by the church which breaks its covenant with the Lord and intoxicates herself with the blood of the faithful witnesses. All wars and revolutions and social injustices and abominations are born within and are fed by the adulterous church. This underscores the significance of the creedal article on the true and false church. This demands the reformation, the return to the Lord. Do you know what I can never understand? While every day and everywhere we see with our eyes the devastation with which the false church regales humanity, a devastation which produces universal sighing, hardly anyone takes the confession concerning true and false church seriously. If one only speaks nice words about unity and makes sympathetic gestures in the direction of ecumenicity, reaching over every ecclesiastical wall, then a person is praised as a fine fellow. But if one confesses the truth about Christ's church, such a person is accused of narrow-minded churchmanship, of absolutism, of fanaticism. Think for a moment about the relationship between us and the synodical churches. The leadership maintain with determination the doctrinal decisions which rob all promises and demands, and thereby the whole covenant with God, of its strength. The great majority, and this perhaps is even worse, doesn't seem to care anymore. All they want is peace and unity. Already voices are being heard favoring reunion with the Reformed State Church. Many in the Netherlands are flirting with the World Council of Churches, and their mission churches in Indonesia are already affiliated with such a council in which communists also occupy influential positions. In this situation, some in our churches are already rejoicing at the possibility of a speedy or eventual reunion with them. But then I would say, be quiet when another war breaks out. When terrorists stalk abroad, as presently in Indonesia, don't open your mouth about Skirmer Horn and BL, but simply announce that here this church of ours has also committed adultery. As long as they do not take the covenant seriously and become faithful to the Lord and thus also to the children of the church, so long should we refuse to think about reunion, let alone even speak about it. The Lord says, come out, that you be not partakers of her sins. Revelation 18 verse 4. I must say something more about that beast. Already, I suppose, you have understood this. After the days of the Roman Empire, the anti-Christian world government could no longer rise to power, for instead of one world empire, there appeared a host of nations who continually waged war with each other. In the place of the beast, we see today as an international power the apostate church. Therefore, John could say, at present the beast is not. The entire civilization of the world has been colored by Christianity. The Antichrist cannot be seen clearly and boldly. Regrettably, everything bears the hallmark of being Christian. But in actuality, it is the false church which permeates and penetrates all of life. Formerly, in the days of Rome and earlier, the beast was, but today he is not there, even though he is. For the beast dwells within the church, but it will come again. The seventh head will appear, says John, and will remain only a short time. Then after a little while, the beast will be completely manifested as the Antichrist in his final appearance, the eighth world ruler. During the Seventh Empire, the church will still be able to maintain her strong position and continue with her adultery. But when the reign of Antichrist comes, there will still be divergent powers, but all of them blind subjects of Antichrist. All their authority they have delivered unto him to be motivated by the same will as he. God himself has put it in their hearts. Today we already can understand this as we see one nation after another delegating or depriving themselves of some of their authority. When this process has run its course, the world dictator will have appeared with all the others blindly following him, even though they insist on exercising dominion within their own realms. At that time, a two-pronged attack begins. The war against the Lamb and his faithful followers, but also the war against the woman, called the harlot. By that time, they are more than disgusted with the secularized Christendom. Those 10 horns, which are the 10 vassals of the Antichrist, the rulers who in association with him exercise authority, will together hate the harlot and uncover her and eat and burn her flesh. Today there is international respect for Christendom, for righteousness, mercy and love to fellow men, and all such things, since men can play a fine game with the false church. But a time will come when they shall loathe her and cast her aside in her nakedness. Would you see some of the symptoms, some glimpses in history, wherein this is beginning to manifest itself? During the war, Hitler was particularly antagonistic toward the Jews, and we trembled because of the gruesome deeds as gas chambers and arrests. Hitler hated the Jews because of what they had done to Germany in the spheres of politics and economics. But these Jews were still the apostate church, and with their adultery, they had polluted Germany, and not Germany alone. World Jewry is guilty of many evils. Thus at last the flames of hatred began to burn. Far be it from me to rationalize the persecution of the Jews, but Jewry, as the apostate church, has exerted tremendous power, and with her abominations has led many astray. Thus the judgment comes, and hate burns brightly. The Russians, in their hatred against the Hungarian Roman Catholics and the Bulgarian Protestants, have seen the church's power in the life of the nation, socially and politically and economically. Yet the church was not the heavenly bride, but a harlot who committed adultery. With her, men make short shrift. And in the days to come, this will take place on an international scale. Therefore the Lord warns, "My people, depart out of the midst of her, that you may escape her plagues." I realize that when this is done, war is declared against the true church and against Jesus Christ. For neither the Antichrist nor his followers will make a distinction. All that bears the name of church, they will seize. But God adds, "Although the Antichrist will make no distinction between church and church, I will do so." For when he opposes the false church, God declares that his purposes are being fulfilled, that his judgment is falling upon the great harlot. But when he wars against the Lamb and his faithful servants, God says that this Lamb is Lord of lords and King of kings. He will triumph with his true church. Oppression will be experienced for a little season, but then we will escape. Revelation 17 gives us at a glance all of world history and enables us to understand the times. Often we find ourselves unable to keep up, even with the best news review of Mr. Jongling's paper. Mr. Peter Jongling is well known under his pen name Pete Prince, the author of the Scout books, published by Inheritance Publications. World events are frequently so confusing and chaotic. But God sets John above the international situation and causes him in the spirit to see it all and then describe it for us in the scriptures. This is the style of the New Testament time, and this shall surely come to pass. When we have understood this, then we know that the issue is not what America has plotted or the United Nations has planned, but rather what is the true church. The basic issue is the problem of the church. That question which men have so lightly dismissed because it is so thorny. But this is undoubtedly the most significant issue of all. The issue is whether the church keeps the covenant and cherishes her children or whether she kills them. We cannot prevent the unfolding of history. When men suggest that we make common cause against communism and thus demonstrate that in unity lies our strength, I would reply, rather stop all this, for we cannot prevent this development. The coming of the seventh head cannot be stopped, nor that of the eighth. But what we can do is to make our decision about the church, whether we will cooperate in the abominations of the harlot, or whether we with Christ as his called and elect and faithful people will keep covenant with him and with each other. We can decide whether we will perish in the judgment which will come upon the great Babel, or whether with Christ we will triumph over the devil and his kingdom. When then Dioka is surrendered and Sukarno returns to lay bare all the shame of the Netherlands, and when we see the international powers play their political game, don't throw your newspaper in fury on the table, but listen to God addressing you in the specific facts. What now do you believe about the one, holy, Catholic Christian Church? Will she be bride or harlot?